So it's an honor to be here. And I've learned a lot in my life as a technologist, but I've also learned a lot trying to start my own businesses. And I've had to deal with a specific topic that I want to share with you guys in case anyone plans on ever going out and trying your own business in the future. Hopefully that will be a good topic and resonate. So my talk is about embracing failure. And if I rewind the clock to my first experience with failure in the business world, it was in 1999. And I found myself sitting across the table from a very upset investor. And the investor was telling me at age 21 that I'd never work in technology again. And that's pretty devastating to hear. So how did I end up there? I had ended up after, if you ask any entrepreneur, sorry, if you ask any investor, how many of their investments they expect to have succeed, they'll tell you 8 of them will probably fail or give marginal return, and 1 or 2 really be substantial contributor to the success of their investment. That means that the majority of businesses that we try and create are more likely to fail than succeed. And at the same time, if you ask the nerds behind the scene, us, who are actually doing the work, you ask us whether our project's going to fail or succeed, and we'll say it's going to succeed. There's no chance of failure. And when we don't actually consider what the impact of success or failure means, we don't really contemplate what our failure plan is, then we can end up in trouble. And failure has a lot of bad stigma. And we learned at a very early age that failing is a bad thing. We get a lot of advice about failure. Not all of it is really that good. And at the same time, the people that we respect and have really changed the world have not just lived with failure, but they've embraced it. There's an early Bill Gates. Got, I think it's Andrew Stanton, early contributor to Pixar. And a Suichiro Honda of Honda Corp. Okay? So who am I? I'm a nerd, because this looks really fun to me. So so does this, and so does this. So I went to school in Santa Barbara, and I got a physics degree, of Santa Barbara, and I got a computer science degree. Then I went back and worked on my computer science PhD, and that's when I met my wife and started to have kids. And she took me from beautiful Santa Barbara, which looks like this, and this. We traded it for Ireland, where she's from, which looks like this, and we had a whole lot of this. So what I found when I was in Ireland is that the tolerance for failure there was a lot less than it was in Santa Barbara or in California. And that got me thinking about how did failure influence me as an entrepreneur, and how could I share those stories? Because more often than not, you hear someone talking about all their successes, which is great and all, but it's usually the failures that help guide you along the way. So I hope there'll be something really practical here as a takeaway. Great. My hobby is programming and building teams and working hard. And I love taking an idea and maturing it into a product. And most of the time, they fail. I've got really good at doing that whole process very, very quickly. So I started when I was in college. Java was just being released. So I did a presentation on the first 1.0 hotspot Java compiler. And I didn't like it. So I've done some Java work back early 2000s, then went into things like PHP, and then went into Ruby on Rails very early on Ruby on Rails. And then most of my projects have now been Ruby on Rails. Most recently, I like Golang. That's a fun. I did one project in Lisp early on the web, and that was one of my most fun projects, but it's impossible to find anyone else to contribute on it. So. So I love failure, and but before I go into the depths of that, I'll tell you a little bit about some of the successes that have come from the failures. I started a number of companies, and I've had a number of exits. Right Skills in cloud computing, if you guys have heard of that. And then I became an advisor and helped advise a number of companies. And then most recently, I tried something else. I tried buying companies that already were operational, and then putting a business and marketing and all the other stuff that's actually not the building of companies on top of the companies that were already running. And that was a business that ended up getting me acquired at Rackspace. So let's dig into the fun stuff here. So back in 1999, had a proper startup, in the garage, eating pizza, real deal. And that was my bed over there, okay? So it was legit, it was a real startup. And what was it? So I had an opportunity to work in industry, and instead I said, you know what, I want to make a video game. So me and a few friends, we went ahead and we raised what we thought was a lot of money, but it was very little money, and we went out to build a video game. And it was a two-dimensional game called Conspire. And in the midst of all of this, we had three pillars. We had our team, our tech, and our funding. And our team had a designer, and our tech, which started 2D, it was right at the time when everything 2D went 3D. And we thought, you know what, we're not going to be able to release this 2D thing, we got to change to 3D. So we dug in and we did our everything, we redid everything with the 3D engine that we built from scratch. We worked really hard to do it. And the designer got fed up because 3D design was actually a lot more difficult than the 2D design. So our designer, he left, and we were working so hard trying to do all of this 3D work that we started neglecting our investors. And we didn't communicate with them. And the longer we didn't communicate, the more they thought we were achieving. And the longer we waited, the greater the divergence got, until that day where I was sitting across from the investor. And he wasn't upset that he lost the money, but that we had set his expectations so poorly. And he was telling me I'd never work in technology again. I have a pilot's license, and you always learn to look at the altitude and make sure you don't fly into the ground. And sometimes, even when you do fly into the ground, you can pick up the pieces and move on. And that's what I did. And so what we were missing in this adventure is we had never really talked through what would happen if we couldn't deliver on the thing we had said we would do. We had never set up an eject plan. We'd never had a failure plan. And so we didn't have one of these, and we flew the plane into the ground. And out of that, what I did learn was, rather than go out and try and build another company for myself at the time, I was young and a bit hurt, I did what any good, after what you should do after any good failure, I became a consultant. So I started a consultancy after the game company, and that consultancy ended up being the vehicle that taught me how to build products to completion for other people. I saw their projects grow and fail, and I learned a lot about what I would later bring to my own. So first lesson I learned from failure was, always, even at the very beginning, talk about what is the failure plan. If things don't go right, what do you do? How do you go back and approach your investors?
You know, by the way, across 101, there's a very famous firm titled Failure Analysis Associates. And you should probably look at the history of them, because their stock investors were told, you can't successfully run a company with failure in the title.
In the title, yeah. I want to write a book and put failure in it.
You should take a look. And see their offices.
I have to say, oh really?
Yeah, and there are other companies, Exponent with a Kai.
Okay. Thank you. Take a look at that. The second thing I learned, the second lesson in failure for me, was a few years later, and I had actually, we'd gotten to the point where instead of two or three kids, we actually had five kids, I think, about then, and realized all the budgeting that I had done for running my consultancy was just not going to work out in the long term for my planning. And so, but wanted to go ahead and go at another startup under my own steam. And so we actually sold the house, big commitment, and we put all that money, as you would with your nice stable family, you sell the house, and you go put all that money into building a new company. So this company idea I thought is brilliant. It was back in 2004, and it was a sending mail from your computer. So if you hit a print driver, you could just pop up a little envelope, you put it to address, you hit send, and then somewhere in the ether, that would be printed out, posted, and mailed. That was the whole idea. So wrote a print driver, the server side was easy, wrote a printer on the other end, a big industrial printer, set up so it would interleave everything and do all the hard work. And so went out to do this, had a lot of fun designing it, really, really enjoyed the process of building the product. And we were good because we were actually executing on the product. This is an entirely different situation on the first time. And this time we had really reasonable goals for what we could achieve. We checked in regularly. We started to do a bit of the iterative development processes that I'm a fan of now, but really didn't know anything about back then. But we did get caught up in a few things. Like I had a partner, and We spent a lot of time talking about like what the thing would look like. This even before we launched. So like this is one version of the product, and I swore that I wanted this version of the product. And I said, you know, that girl there is really important. That's going to make us successful. And there's a lot of like real heavy conversations because we never really had launched anything, so we weren't getting any user feedback. It was just us talking. And my partner said, no, it needs to be a dog. That dog, he's going to lick all the stamps. So we had just heated discussions about this. And what happened was, we waited an awful long time to really put the product in front of our customers. So even though we had built the product, we were refining a product that really should have been in the market. And we learned this lesson when we did put the product in the market, that the customer lifetime value, which is how much you'll make from your customer for the lifetime of them being your customer, minus the cost that it takes you to acquire a customer, and this is really in any business, depending, no matter if it's online or enterprise sales, is a number. And you want that number to be a positive number. So in other words, if you're going to make $1,000 off your customer over their lifetime and it costs you $100 to get them, then you've got $900 to spend on the core development, all the overhead and running your company, and hopefully have some profit. And we found is that because we were a postal service in a real new way of thinking, no one wanted to really trust us with a long-term relationship. So they would give us about $15. That would be like a prepaid account or the most we could get from our average basket. And we were paying about $400 to attract that customer. So the economics, they're really not that good. And that forced us to have a bit of a meeting about the company. And we had to come up with our failure plan. So we said, what are we going to do now? And so we said, because eventually you feel like if you just keep at it long enough, maybe these numbers will correct themselves. We said, no, we're going to be analytical. We're going to tie ourselves to a 90-day plan. And we wrote down all the different channels that we were going to test. And we wrote down all the different changes we were going to make to the landing pages, probably put the dog back in or put the girl back in. And then we did that. We went out and we tried to get everything done. And in the end, after making this plan, it turns out that it didn't work. It was absolutely not going to work. We could not make the economics work. But we time-bound how much we were going to put into that effort. We did it analytically. We felt good about the process. We communicated every step of the way. And we actually had a great experience, even though the business failed. And because we enjoyed working together, and we knew that we had a team that could execute, we said, let's just do another one. So this thing gone, and we started on the next idea.
Did your capital partners stay with you as you rode through this? In other words, did they also appreciate that you were navigating cleanly?
Yeah, this was an entirely different experience than the first one.
So your money people stayed with you?
Stayed with us. And you'll see, so the next one, which was right on the back of this one, you know, it steals a lot of the same elements. So ASAP Brands was like the holding company. So the investors just carried right along. We gave them a new plan and set new expectations, new failure plan, what we have to achieve. And what we saw from the people that were sending posted, the postal product, was that, can I tell in inappropriate anecdotes, or is this for posterity in here? Can I be a little inappropriate?
It's for posterity, so go ahead.
Okay, great, I'm going to do it. Okay. Jew is a culture, right? Is that a religion or is it a culture? Can we call it a culture?
Jewish?
Can we say it's cultural? Okay, my partner and I in this project, Jews. Culturally Jews. I hated to mail anything. I had people that I needed to invoice and I didn't like invoicing my customers. This is back with the post product. So we built the product because I hated to mail anything. I was, you know, I had to send an invoice and I didn't have the right paper or my toner was out and I didn't like to go to the store and I was just lazy. So the whole point of the project was to not have to do that ever. But what turns out is after we launched the post ASAP product, the two people that used it, one was people that were sending invoices just like me. And the other one was a Baptist church. And this Baptist church sent so many letters. And we had this turnaround time of 24 hours that we wanted to give for our customers. And they might send it during the day, and we're busy during the day. We're not going to spend time, you know, licking envelopes and stuffing everything in. And we had to, you know, we had all these interleaved flyers to go out, but we still had to, someone had to stuff them. So at 2 o'clock in the morning, my partner and I would go down to the office. And at first it was exciting, you know, it's like opening up presents because you see all this mail coming in and you get to like see real customers and it's like actual business that's happening. And so we were stuffing all these envelopes, and then at the end of the day, we just looked at each other, and we just started laughing, because it's like 2 o'clock in the morning. We built the products that we'd never have to mail, and we were there in the office together, like, putting all these flyers in together. It was just really, really funny for us. So, is that fair? That's reasonable?
Sure.
Okay.
What's going to happen? What's worst case? Are you going to get fired?
Oh, nothing like that. Just making sure.
Little outside his house.
And the levity now. We'll move on. So what we found is we were going to focus on the invoicers. We thought those guys we were actually resonant with. So we made a new product for invoicing. And we actually, we wanted it to be really simple online invoicing. That was the goal. But when we were looking at the product, we said, well, wait, our competition is really QuickBooks at the time. There was no, the online invoicing space was really not there yet. It hadn't matured. And so we started to ask our customers what they wanted. And our customers were used to QuickBooks. So rather than really simple online invoicing, they started asking for really complex online invoicing. So we got more and more features that we put in this product. And at the same time, we were concerned about the go-to-market side that we had just experienced on the previous product. And so we started building a lot of our marketing materials earlier, which is great. We got a lot of that marketing out in front of our customers. And I think I was going through a phase because a lot of these, I think I was the creative director at this point for a lot of these. But we spent a lot of time, we spent equal times on our marketing as on the core product. And what ended up happening, though, is that by listening to our customers, we ended up building a product that was just as complex as QuickBooks, the thing that we were saying was so miserable and that we were trying to replace with simple online invoicing. And it really hit us that we had gone so far in a direction that we weren't passionate about when we saw the launch of this thing called BlinkSale. This is right around 2006. And BlinkSale was actually simple, easy online invoicing. It was a gorgeous product in that it lacked all complexity whatsoever. And it really kicked off a space that of these like lightweight web apps that seem to get adopted extraordinarily quickly because it's so easy to onboard. This would be the era of like 37 signals when they came out with the to-do list and that unseated Microsoft project, right? So we said, wait a second, we just got led into building a product that we didn't want to build in the first place. We were dispassionate about it, and we ended up putting that project to bed. Out of the ashes of that business, we said, let's take a bigger pain, one that's broader, and really simplify something that's complex and hard and make it simple. And we ended up going right into the next opportunity, which was in e-commerce. And we made a copy and paste widget that would do your e-commerce, so you wouldn't have to install any back end at all. You just put a little bit of JavaScript, it would render a cart, a little bit of JavaScript would render a purchase button. You click the purchase button, it would throw a request out that would update the JavaScript, and you could make like a blog into a shopping cart. You know, back in 2006, it was pretty cool. And that thing got acquired very, very quickly. So my history with failure is that failure's been something that's driven me through one after another into finally finding the techniques that have made me successful. And I don't know if any of you have had the chance to entrepreneur yet. And maybe just like by a show of hands, how many people have a company right now? Okay. So when you have a company, do you ever think about what it takes to shut it down? Maybe you do. You look sophisticated. How many people have had a company? Show of hands. Okay. Did you know when you had that company how you'd shut it down? Okay. I had no idea. Never even, you know, like it was like, I had no idea the tactics. I don't know how much money to keep in the bank to make it happen. I knew nothing about it. But here I am, supposed to be sophisticated, running my own business. And I don't know the first thing about how much money to save as a reserve account to put the thing away, or how to communicate it, or what my liabilities would extend on. So before setting into a venture, I encourage everyone to take a look at what is the other side of the venture. When things go wrong, what does it look like? Another great thing that exercise does is it tells you what it looks like when you're successful. Because more and more, when I talk to people running companies, they raise a lot of money or they start making profit, it's hard for them to know if they're successful. If you've just raised $20 million and you're worth $100 million, are you successful? Or do you now have to build a $500 million company? Or if you're a very tiny company and you've taken no investment and you're making millions of dollars, are you successful? Maybe not as much revenue as that other company that raised the $20 million, but maybe for you, for your goals, it is actually much more successful. So the second thing is, the second takeaway is to always stick to the metrics. So if you have, once you know what the know your plan is and you communicate it, make sure that you review it and that you hold yourself accountable to it. It takes diligence to actually do, but in the end, it's been something that's been very helpful for me. I have a couple anecdotes. So in a future business, we did something called Write Signature. And Write Signature was a product that let people do online signatures. Okay, so I think it's the way of the future. We're, in 10 years, people aren't going to want more paper in their work life. You're going to want to sign things on your phone or sign things on your tablet screen or sign things from your computer. So we built a product that did just that. And it was a great product and really elegant, solved the need. But at day one, it had no customers because no product really has a customer on the first day. And at the same time, we wanted to make money. So we wanted to put a billing system in so we could take money from our customers, but we didn't have any customers. And we had just built all these products, like the Post ASAP and the Bill ASAP, and we put beautiful billing systems into these things. Like there was like promo codes, and you could take visas and international codes. And each one of these things takes time and attention to do right. And at the time, there was not services that do it elegantly, like Stripe. And so when we got to Write Signature, we just didn't build the billing system. And because we didn't want to put time into something and then have no one to bill. So instead, we let people put their credit card numbers in, and we would accept the credit card number, and you can do a little like CRC check to make sure that it's the right rough digits, and then we would just throw them out. And then we'd let the customer use their product. And we'd keep track of it. We'd say, you know what, we should be making $300 this month. You know, that's great. But we're not going to spend 6 weeks to put the billing system in. Not yet. Then the next month came by, and maybe we're making $600. And we said, you know what, we're just not going to do that billing system. Next month came by, and maybe we're making $1,200. Still didn't put the billing system in. We waited about 12 months before we put the billing system in. And then when we did, we just notified our customers that we had a glitch in our billing system and they needed to re-enter their data. And it actually worked out really well for us. But it kept us focused on what was really important. It wasn't important for us at the time to get the $300. We were spending a lot more than that.
None of them called and said, you're not billing me?
We had zero complaints of not billing. There was zero, absolute zero complaints.
Didn't that tell you you were inessential to them? Because I've got a gardener, and I tell him he charges too little because if he doesn't charge enough, he'll go out of business, and I'll have to find a new gardener. And that's worth, and that's a giant hassle. So if he doesn't get paid, it makes my life worse. So none of your customers saw you as that essential to their lives that they wanted to keep you in business.
Yeah, at the time, I think we probably had the persona of a company doing a little bit better than we were. So I don't think anyone thought that if they snuck out from paying us the $12 a month that we were going to shutter our doors. But we didn't convert everyone when we went to paying, but we don't notice it now. And I think the time that we saved early on by being really true to what was important to our business was very helpful.
Yeah, I'm not questioning the
No, it's we didn't. We had zero. There was no complaints.
Okay.
That's good.
Did you not have this massive churn right when you forced people to re-enter their
there was some.
Payment information where they said, oh, I'm not going to bother?
There was some. But at that point, the trajectory of the business, our new conversions were so strong, we just didn't look back. I mean, it also gave us flexibility, right? Like, you want to go out and find the right price for your product in the marketplace. So what do? You make landing pages. Landing page gives a customer to your website a custom experience. Like if we have a real retail store, like a restaurant, and we want to open it on University Avenue, and we say, do we want to open up a hummus shop or are we going to open up an Indian shop? We kind of got to make a decision, right? We can't both be a hummus shop and an Indian shop. Got to open one or the other. So you have capital costs, you got to invest all that money, and you got to build it. And that sucks, because if you're wrong about what the market wanted, you're stuck with an Indian shop when it should be a hummus shop. And online, we don't have that problem. And if we don't take advantage of I love to take advantage of the fact that every person to my shop can either see it as a hummus shop or an Indian shop online. And then I can find out the people that give me the best return on of one or the other type of product, I can then focus in on what they want. In order to do that, you build landing pages. And a landing page might describe your product in one way to one customer and your product in another way to another customer. One variable there might be pricing. So you might see a $10 a month pricing on one landing page that some of your customers get. You might see $15 a month on the other. If you change nothing else but the price and there's no difference in conversion rate, what do you assume? That you have an inelastic demand for the product and you can increase the pricing without losing any revenue. So we did that. We would run different pricing with this Write Signature product. And since we didn't have a billing system, we could charge whatever we wanted in the marketing copy, and it was never processing any credit cards, so no one was ever going to complain that they were got a, I signed up on the $25 plan, but you only charged me $15, or I signed up on the $15 and you charged me $25. That wasn't an issue because we didn't charge them anything. And then we figured out what the right pricing was, and we announced the pricing change, and everyone got to the same level. But we still do that today, and a lot of people do. You'll run like a little campaigns and special tests. So the third thing is what we experienced when we built out the Bill ASAP product. We tried to do this online invoicing only to find that as we pushed and pushed and pushed, the thing that we wanted just seemed to not materialize in front of us. And maybe, who knows, if we kept pushing at that product, maybe it could have been a massive company today. But from my perspective, every entrepreneur has to get comfortable where they see opportunity to go forward and where they're in a cul-de-sac and there's really no way out. And that's really a personal, it's a personal decision. Okay, three takeaways. And so the thing we call failure is not the falling down, it's the staying down. So I encourage anyone, I reemphasize that to anyone, that failure is a critical process to finding success. Couple other things, some housekeeping, then I'd love to take some Q&A, is a part of Rackspace. Okay, Rackspace is relevant for a number of reasons. One is that the way that people develop software today is changing. Instead of taking long 6-month development processes, the sort of waterfall development, we're trying more and more to bring products out really quickly so they can be responsive to the market. It's happening internally in Rackspace, and it's happening across many, many, many of our customers. And it's more than just agile processes. You asked me about like what languages do I use. There's a whole set of tool selection that I say that modern business builders use. Okay, so if you're using a C to write your website today, you're probably not going to be as dynamic to respond to the market pressures as someone who's using something like Ruby or Python. If you're using agile, you're probably going to be more responsive than if you're using waterfall. And there's a host of other choices, like do you use a cloud-based service, or do you outsource the DevOps chores that you have, or do you keep them within your org and sort of order metal and wait for the metal to be delivered? Modern organizations are making choices to move quicker and to use services like what Rackspace offers in order to do that. They acquired my company Exceptional because Exceptional is one of those tools in the agile development process. We measure product quality after launch. So you can move really quickly and get feedback about how the product's going and really only focus on the things that are real problems that you find in production. Second thing that Rackspace has relevant to this group is there's a Rackspace office in San Francisco. And within there, there's an incubator program, which includes Rackspace credits. So if anyone is interested in doing a startup in downtown San Francisco and leveraging the technology at Rackspace, then reach out to me and I'll be happy to make an introduction to the guys who are running this here. With that, happy to take some Q&A.
There's apparently been some migration in cloud computing because it's easy to relocate, and the pressures associated with a surveillance system have caused some customers to move. Have you noticed that in your management of business affairs?
Great. So I'm just going to caveat that for all Rackspace perspective, I'm relatively new to the company. So I'm going to give you really more my perspective, mm-hmm. and I'll give you some Rackspace flavor wherever I can.
Sure.
So one of the things that Rackspace did, which I think is a very strategic thing, is today, you know, Amazon really has overinvested in capital for their cloud infrastructure, well beyond what anyone else has done to date. Mm-hmm. And you've got people like Google, and Microsoft is pretty infinite budget with Azure, but not the market traction yet. But so you have you have all this capital expense. And Rackspace is actually a small company relative to any of those other three players. So Rackspace found themselves with a cloud offer, which was based off some proprietary technology. And they said, you know what, if we open source what we've done, we share the development cost among the whole community. And sure enough, someone else can come in and enter our market, but we're going to be good at the operationalizing of the software rather than the core development of it, which operationalizing has always been Rackspace's strength, the fanatical support and operationalizing. If you imagine, everyone here is familiar with Rackspace, but 10 years ago, if you looked at Rackspace, Rackspace had the largest number of Red Hat certified engineers outside of Red Hat. Now, they didn't write Red Hat, they didn't write Linux, but they had all the right people that you'd want supporting your product on Linux. In the same way, there was sort of a return to roots. It's by open sourcing OpenStack. And OpenStack is a cloud in a box, right? So it has a, you know, all the pieces that you need to manage and deploy a cloud-like virtual environment on top of your infrastructure. And what they found is companies now want to take a cloud and put it internal to their environment. And your choices today might be something like a VMware, or you might have a like Eucalyptus, or there's some minor vendors in the space. But the majority of the market seems to be really embracing OpenStack for their private deployments of a general purpose cloud. And because Rackspace is the parent of OpenStack, Rackspace is now providing a lot of those private clouds.
So you're providing services to people's private, they're owning the hardware, and your workforce is administering their internal cloud machine.
Yeah, I mean, I think a challenge to you guys is to say, fast forward. See, when Amazon first launched their cloud, I had the opportunity to see it very early on, and I realized that there was some efficiency to be had by not having to wait for the 4 to 6 weeks for your hardware to be provisioned and just get access to your usable equipment right away. And that's where RightScale came out of, because we started heavily adopting the Amazon cloud and then realized you have a virtual machine sprawl. You've got all these machines everywhere and you don't know how to manage them. And so we built a product that would help make that easier for the users of cloud. Well, time's gone on, and cloud can be actually a really great thing or it can be a really miserable thing. And it really depends on a lot. It depends on the specific economics of the cloud providers. If everyone is charging a premium on cloud, and if you imagine cloud should have some premium because there's some added value that's happening, but if the premium's too high, then when you develop your applications, you might constantly be saying, wait a second, I should really get back to hardware. Once I reach a steady state and I don't need some of the bursting abilities from cloud, then I should go back to hardware, because at that point I'm removing the margin that the cloud vendors are putting on there, and I can go back to that better value, more like a optimization seeker. So with the internal clouds today, some people are building internal clouds because they don't want to be on a public cloud where they have commingled anything. They don't want to share resources. They don't want to have unknown entities amidst in their infrastructure. So in that case, you own your own hardware. You put it in your own closet. You know where it is. And now you can manage it and get some of the benefits, thanks to OpenStack, of what a public cloud would give you. Now, the other side is, well, maybe you just want a logically separated cloud. Okay, so you want your own resources that aren't going to be saturated by another neighbor, but you don't really want it in your closet. So you want it maybe in Rackspace's closet. So we have some customers that actually want their own OpenStack, their own private cloud, within their own closet. Some of them want it in ours, in our data center. And some are happy just with the general purpose public cloud, where there's multiple tenants and everyone shares together.
Can you reserve resources in that public cloud? In other words, is there a bulk QoS facility for guaranteeing margin?
There are different services have different levels of reservation ability, but it's really on a service-by-service basis. The ultimate control is really going to be on those private deployments. And the private deployments can also do things like a general purpose. What the cloud today has a very general purpose units. So early days, we were deploying things on Amazon, and we realized that we needed a load balancing tier. Okay, and the load balancing tier, we figured out it was just going to pass a lot of traffic, and it didn't have to have a lot of sophistication. So it didn't need a lot of CPU, it didn't need a lot of memory, it didn't need a lot of disk. All it needed was network traffic. So we provisioned, and in our model, we said we're going to put these very tiny nodes, which Amazon offered at the time. And maybe they had 4 or 5 flavors. And we said, with the tiniest one, this makes a lot of sense to move to Amazon. We can burst, we can do all this stuff. But it turns out when we went to do our deployment, the smallest nodes also got small network. And we didn't know that. It wasn't even clear at the time that that happened. But if you have a physical machine with 32 virtual machines, and you only got one of the virtual machines, you got 1/32nd of the network. So that whole planning that we did for this load balancing tier was based on the idea that we would only need these little machines. And in the end, we had to get much bigger ones. They sat idled, but it gave us the network traffic that we wanted. Now, the point there is that these are generalized compute structures that you're getting within a cloud environment. And sometimes you actually want very specific structures. Maybe you want something with a ridiculous amount of memory. You want a special card like Fusion I/O for your particular processing need. And so the cloud today has not yet satisfied the complete array of tasks. And more often than not, a custom deployment, when you reach that steady state, starts to look really, really attractive, especially anything that touches like data stores and that kind of stuff.
You mentioned a series of companies. How many investors dragged along the whole way, and why?
Yeah.
Because you kept losing their money.
Losing money, that's true.
First off, the scale at which I did things was not epic. It was trifles, I'd say, in the grand scheme of things. And now that I'm on the investor side at times, every time I make an investment, I write off that money. It's never coming back to me. I never make an investment in entrepreneuring space and think, oh my goodness, if I don't have that, the kids aren't getting their presents this year. Okay, so with that perspective, I see why the people that I've made investments in, the people that have communicated well to me, I'd back them in the next thing even if they hit hiccups, because there's so much that happens that's out of your control. And if you communicate well and you have high integrity and you do all the other things right, then why wouldn't you want to work with that person again? So answer my question from another perspective. I don't know why they would have particularly followed through with me.
But. It's the opposite of the guy who told you you'd never work in tech again. It's the antithesis. It's the, when you talk about the working relationship being worth more than the capital that was lost.
That's absolutely right.
I mean, you see this today. I mean, you see this with investors, big investors, proper VCs that make investments in companies that they burn out, and the entrepreneur barely escapes out, but gets funded again to do the next thing. And we're really resilient to failure here. I think we're remarkably. And whenever I've traveled, I'm like amazed that people say like, no, that guy did that thing 10 years ago and failed. And I'm like, whoa, yeah, this is like the, especially like Ireland, a small country. It's a lot more, we're very open to failure here.
Rhetorical question. What's the smallest invoice that you've ever sent?
The smallest invoice?
I ask that because I want to know if you encourage hackers, that is to say hackers in the good sense, who want to experiment with an idea, and they're trying to do it on their hobby money.
So, how do you mean though? You're saying the smallest invoice from?
Rackspace. From you, from Rackspace.
Oh, yeah, we send invoices for pennies.
Okay,
yeah.
Thank you.
Invoices for pennies. And I mean, that's actually good. That's a good point, too.
Micropayments.
So, I don't think we do micropayments yet. I did see something funny. I saw someone writing in and complaining. You know, there's some services that have like $5 a month plans, right?
Hard to get it for free.
And you have to be careful what you wish for. Because some of these $5 a month plans, companies, they sort of like grow really, really fast, because $5 seems like a lot of value to get anything nowadays. And if you read the forums and you read what people complain about, someone was complaining that they ran a server on this $5 a month service for a portion of the month, and then they had canceled it and they wanted to get their money back, but because it had already hit the billing, the $5 had already gone, and the guy had done the calculation and said, wait a second, I was only using it for these days during the month, and so prorating my $5, I should get back exactly this much. And I felt bad for the support person who must have been on the other end saying, like, it would be better if we just gave him the money. Then by the time I answered this email and everything else that goes with it, we're already out more than just if we had to deliver it. But no, I look at it and I say, back in the late 90s when I was doing consulting and seeing people build businesses, we'd raise $5 million. And of that money, we'd send $3 million if it would actually go to big companies that already existed. We'd be paying Oracle, we'd be paying Sun, we'd buy like Cisco equipment, we'd put in like T1 lines. We were raising money and giving it to big companies, which is kind of weird. And then whatever was remaining, we would use to, I guess, buy like JBoss licenses or something. We would pay ourselves and we'd try and deliver on that big amount of money that we raised. And I did the math and I said, well, what if I took like the $3,000 that I paid for my development workstation 15 years ago, and I took that same $3,000 and I tried to do something today as an entrepreneur. And I realized, you buy a domain name, it's maybe like $9 a year if you find the right place. You find some hosting. We have some inexpensive servers that you can get started with, these relatively cheap servers. It might be $500 for the year if you buy one. Then you might add to that DNS, and we actually give DNS for free, so you don't have to do anything there. And then you might want some project management. You go to GitHub, and GitHub has a nice They have a nice code revision control and all the issue tracking. And then you might want to do some marketing. So you go and you need a logo. So you go to 99 Designs, and for $100, you actually get your logo. You might meet a human sometimes. You go to VistaPrint, and for $20, you get some business cards. And right, and you just keep going, and you realize you can get your landing pages built. You can, for a few $100, you can buy 100 visitors to your website through Google, if or StumbleUpon, or any channel you like, and you can get a immediate feedback on whether the idea is good. And you can do this whether or not it's a software installed application, piece of hardware, new network technique, a machine learning algorithm. You can advertise and actually see through to a really, you can take your business so far into validation today that I'm delighted. I'm delighted at the tools that are available.
And you can do all that before it actually works.
You can do it all before it works. And I think I said, like, for $3,000, you could do the whole thing.
Except for the actual making.
Something. Except for making it. But you know what? I try and separate mentally. I love building stuff. I love building stuff for the sake of the building of stuff. Just like my kids will take Legos, and they'll put the Legos together. Sometimes they'll take, like, a house, and they'll put, like, train tracks on it, and they'll put a gun on the top and wings on the side. And if you walked up and said, oh, my God, I wanted a house with train tracks with a gun and wings, that's perfect, it's just what I was looking for, they would give it to you. They'd take any money you're willing to give them, and they'd take that money, they'd go down to the toy store, and they'd buy more Legos. So that's what I do on some part of my life when I build technology. I build stuff that I know going in is never going to make a penny, but I have to do it. I just have to do it. I built a MakerBot. It was not a rep wrap. It was not a monetary rewarding exercise for me, but I had to do it. It was a lot of fun. I found that of the things that I do that are in technology, there's some things that I like to do. There's a whole spectrum of those things that I like to do. And then there's some things that the market responds to. And if I spend my time doing the things that the market responds to, I get a secondary benefit, which is success, right? And it's kind of fun, too, when you see people actively using the thing that you built. That's really, really fun.
So did your kids sell you a little house with a gunner and wings?
No.
Are they little entrepreneurs who are...
No, not no entrepreneur. My kids are all young right now.
How old?
10, 8, 7, 6, 5, 3. One on the way.
So this is all webbish sort of things. You mentioned sort of in passing you could do the market validation for hardware, but how do we get the hardware development costs down to do hardware startups?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a great question. So I'll answer in two parts, okay? And I'll talk about anything, actually, here, even when I have no advice that's probably reasonable for it, but I'll give it anyway. So the first one is the hardware side on Kickstarter. I love funding Kickstarter projects. There's a group of people out of Cambridge that are doing quadcopters, one of the first quadcopter groups to have a commercial product, and called the R10. And these guys, just inspirationally, see them building little, like, microcontrollers and, you know, hooking up avionics that never really been combined at low cost in the way they do it, and manufacturing going aluminum, using 3D printing to get ad hoc componentry down, model everything first, you know, just on demand, and then kickstarting their project, raise hundreds of thousands of dollars, have a hard time running the business side because their passion isn't for the business, and, you know, shipping boxes and counting receipts is not something they're thrilled by, but... I think the platforms, like, you know, those platforms are fantastic. I'm going to get a boosted board, an idea that I could get, you know, like this high power skateboard with lithium batteries in it. You know this thing? It's a lithium battery based skateboard. And, you know, you look at the work these guys are doing, it's all hardware. It's all sold on a dream. And I'm delighted to be part of it and can't wait to get one. I think that's huge.
So have you placed your order?
Oh, yeah. No, I'm getting mine. Very soon.
We want to see a picture of you riding.
Oh, absolutely, I'll do that. But second thing, so what else? Like, how could I extend this outside of just software? Because, you know, we've got a lot of things that we're interested in our lives. One of the things that interested me when I was in Ireland was the whole pub scene. Like, a pub is like an extension of the living room. And people went to it, they bought drinks, they stayed there for hours, had a lot of drinks. I said, why don't we have something like this in Southern California? Because in Southern California, you have, like, bars, and bars are trendy, and they're a little abrasive. Where's a place that's more like your living room? So I came back to California from Ireland, and I said, why not open up pubs? So I had a friend who ran a pub, and he wanted to expand, and we decided we'd go and do a pub together. No. We looked at where the areas we could build the pub were. And I had this thought process of the hummus shop or the Indian store, right? Do you make it an Irish pub? Do you make an English pub? Well, we're going to make an Irish pub. But do you do it in one city or do you do it in another city? So we actually put up a set of surveys and ads, and we ran them on Facebook. And we ran an ad, city targeted. We could even demographically target. So we could say people from here to here with these interests, with these relationship statuses, whatever you want to find within Facebook. You target it, and you look at what your performance on the marketing is, and that told us where we were probably going to have a better location, whether it was going to be in Santa Barbara or Camarillo. And so we ended up doing that. We built a first location. Then 18 months later, we used the same technique. We built out a second location. 6 months later, we did the same thing. We built out another location. And those are and we benefit from all the ads and people and the likes that we bought along the way.
What was the first location?
It was in Camarillo. And then we did Agora Hills and Thousand Oaks.
So all have dotted. Have you been to the pub over in Half Moon Bay?
haven't been to a pub in Half Moon Bay. Last time in Half Moon Bay, I don't think I could drink.
Cameron's?
Yep. Is that where the jazz happens?
I don't know. I've only been there in the daytime.
So give me an interest area here for you guys.
Provably secure computing. It seems like we need an open source CPU that's all the way from the fab line, verified CPUs with transparent package tops so that you can basically see that it's a no-nonsense situation going on with respect to the silicon at the core of the cloud.
I agree with you. I have a issue. No, my issue is this. So I see something, and I'm pretty technical, and I see something that says it's a new Android distribution, and this Android distribution on this phone is going to give you private calls. All the privacy that you've been wanting is now going to be baked into the Android OS. I'm kind of sophisticated. I look at that, and I say, well, part of me says, sure, they can do it.
Open Kernel Labs already has deployed it.
But on the other side, I say, like, well, you know, I'm actually also not sophisticated enough to know if there's a secondary way of, you know, actually instrumenting my processor so that regardless of what you do in the kernel, it's still leaking
that's
credentials.
That's why the silicon needs to be vetted all the way down.
Well, so my point was that I think it's a messaging issue. Like, if we talk about a digital signature, okay, what's a digital signature? Like we use signatures in commerce all the time, right? We sign something to say what? We sign something to say, I agree to that contract. But the signature, the digital signature, and what actually got put in law is actually a combination of a lot of things. It's like your RSA two-factor token, right? And it's a digital fingerprint of a document that can be checked against a future document to match those two fingerprints.
And there's a secret which you hold.
Yeah.
If your mechanism for holding the secret is secured, which is its own issue.
So the question is, if we have digital signatures, the people that use the digital signatures will have no idea whether the technology they're using is sound or not. That's my point. All they really care is that they want to sign the document. And if they move their finger...
But that's very different for situations where there are potential eavesdroppers who have ulterior motives, for instance, like hijacking an otherwise democratic process.
No, I agree that if we could flip a switch, we'd have all of these high quality, tamper-proof devices and infrastructure and software at our disposal, I would love that. I would flip that switch all the time.
Well, I think there's an emerging demand.
I agree with that, but I think it's going to be really hard to decide whether that, you know, first we probably thought it was at the at the network operation centers that were having listening devices in them, and then we probably thought, oh my goodness, maybe there's some patches into SSL, right? There's some leaks here. Well, and now we know it's actually much deeper, right?
Well, it's soon to be in the microcode, if not already.
Well, so my only point is, I'm never going to be sophisticated enough to know that the platform I'm on is actually predictably secure.
You mean
secure.
You can't offer a service where you supply silicon, which...
How do you trust the person? You said you were going to look at the die.
Well,
you can't look at tokens.
You open source the design.
You can't look at tokens.
I'm well aware of that.
Yeah. So there's no way for
Well, but, if you can't hijack the design by corrupting some of the transistors, the doping layers don't matter because all you can do is destroy the integrity of the device.
I think the interesting thing would be, how do you get that to be consumer? How do you get that right dialogue going so the buyer understands enough to make an intelligent decision?
Well, I see the market and the necessity. I work in information theoretic social decision systems, which is basically where democracy is going when you apply information theory. And there's a rather worrisome result, which is the ideal of democracy, which is true representation of the electorate, requires the input of their desires. And if those desires are surveilled as opposed to used for the purpose of aggregating consensus, they become the foundation of a state of tyranny. So we end up in a situation where we have to face up to this surveillance state, and we have to basically say that if democracy is to exist, this particular compute domain must be exempt from surveillance. The domain which aggregates consensus across a democracy has to be trustworthy, otherwise people will only tell it what it wants to hear, and we will not get democracy. So for that to happen, we need silicon which in the public view is entirely trustworthy and secure. At this point, we have such an erosion of trust that this crisis creates a marketplace for a new generation of CPUs. And the question is, does Rackspace see business potential in this? Andy Bechtolsheim has left a great open spark. Okay, we have a starting point to build this. And for that matter, if one goes to Andreas and says, we want to take this to the next level, you can bet he'll go, where do I write the check? The question is, are we going to build the trustworthy chip that everybody can count on?
Mm-hmm. So I think on the silicon level, that's not our game. But what we
will... It's not your game?
It's not our game. We don't touch the silicon.
Okay.
But if you want an air gap between your closet and anyone else's, we'll make sure it's there for you. Or if you want to be within your data center, that's really the level of our involvement.
Is it a soundproof room? Because these days you can listen to a CPU and back out.
If you want it soundproof, we'll make it soundproof. The things we fight more, we fight the social engineering that comes into our support department that tries to whittle its way into getting access to things. Then we have absolute measures to try and just keep all sorts of sophisticated attacks across, and most of them do not depend on any exploits on the underlying systems themselves.
Well, okay.
And that keeps our hands full.
How would you describe the scale of Rackspace today?
Yeah.
In terms of employees, in terms of business, in terms of compute capacity, whatever you can say.
Yeah, so we have right now, by a measure that we would feel, a measure that I believe to be true, is that we have the second largest public cloud. I think that's probably a good measure for where we stand. And this is there's different ways of measuring cloud. Like for instance, Azure might get bundled with other purchases with Microsoft. So the sales might be greater than our cloud, but we think by actual usage, we have the second largest cloud. So we do see a lot of interesting things, like when Bitcoin has sort of skyrocketed. So some people have tried to do mining in the cloud, and that represents problems because the cloud, when you do your economics, you over-tenant things. Okay, so you might sell 20 CPUs 30 times because if it's very unlikely that all the different people on that CPU are going to need all of its power at one point in time. What you find is that when Bitcoin mining came out, all of a sudden, we had a lot of over-provisioning on a lot of machines. So we get to have some fun in the way that we pack all the tenants into our infrastructure. And that's really just operational concerns of running a massive set of multiple tenants at scale. And I think we run into problems that no one else is really solving right now and talking about, right? So like Amazon has had failure modes where they did not even know it could be a failure mode. You might have like an API server within a zone. Are you guys roughly familiar with the way the cloud stuff, the language here? They have like zones, and zones will have an API controller that controls what happens in the zone. But when things go wrong, We've all automated everything. We've automated everything. So what happens? A machine goes down in zone one because zone one is having a problem. Let's say it's 1A, and you might have a 1B. So what does everyone want to do? They want to migrate everything out of that zone. So now, automated systems start piling up on top of the API server. And the API server in that realm gets overwhelmed. So now you have a double problem. You had a zone have an issue, and now the control interface, the control plane for that zone, is now unable to move all the tenants out because of the rush that happened afterwards. Hard to predict that all that automation was in place until you see it happen first and you see these rapid responses to that downtime triggering a secondary downtime issue. So we get to spend a lot of our time looking at that. Particular areas that are painful for us, if anyone wants to solve some hard problems, software and networking. Software networking at scale in a multi-tenant environment is really tough. You have all of these logical units spread throughout. You have all these physical units spread throughout your data center. And you want to have them later on act like logically contiguous units. So what does that mean? I've got 160 racks in the data center, and they're all filled with servers. And because it's cloud stuff, I can provision it ahead of time. So we build them rack at a time, and we put them in the data center. Now, someone wants a server. Well, we might give them a server on the very first rack because we have some free space. And we don't know how big that client is going to get because they start out small. Well, time goes on, and maybe it's a gaming customer, and that game really takes off. So they then add another unit, but that might be in the third rack, you know, that 160 racks, or it might be in the 18th rack, or it could be the 159th rack and almost at the end of our physical structure. And so to get all the data to transfer back and forth between those nodes and act reasonably, just even configuring, letting the nodes know that each other exist, starts to hit into some hard problems. If you look at the network, you have some traditional things that you would do, like VLANs, to work around some of that crosstalk. But VLANs aren't sophisticated in the way that you need when you have that at scale. And VLANs even top out at like a 4096 is a hard-coded number in the VLAN spec for the number of networks that you can have simultaneously on the same domain. And in our world, we exceed those. We exceed the basic expectations for what the routing protocols can do. So that calls on us to become more sophisticated in how we lay out our topologies. But in the end of the day, we'd love to have those problems solved. That would be an area that we were very interested in investing. Is anyone doing networks? Any network focus here?
I understand the problems. So you don't have like serious mathematicians working on rapid solvers for optimized network topologies?
We do not.
Why not?
We do not.
I mean, there are people here at Stanford who do that kind of stuff.
Well, I would love to meet them. No, you know, our DNA, again, as a company, has been in fanatical support. So what fanatical support means is if you have a Google server and something goes wrong, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if you talk to a PhD as you try and get that minor problem with your Gmail account resolved, because they have an incredible resource there.
So do you also talk to the people at HP who represent what used to be called Tandem?
Me? Yeah. I have not. Should I?
You might, because they've been at it for a few decades. I mean, I know about a little bit about you guys as well, too. But
I mean, what we're seeing is that our DNA is back on, you know, having a wonderful experience from, you know, system administrative level up to, you know, interpersonal relationships. We crush that. That's our domain.
Are you following Andreas Bechtolsheim's latest startup, where software-defined networks with FPGAs at their core?
So I'm not heading that, but I've done a bit of a survey, and there's some really cool stuff on like merchant silicon, where you use the standard network chips, the Trident 2s, the things that are already being put into the Cisco's, and you just rewrite the OS or even leverage a little Linux machine next to the hardware level routing, and you can get some really cool advantages. There's problems though, because
you know about Net FPGA, which the reference platform for experimental networks.
I
started here.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
We'll talk after.
What at the same time though, we have recognized that as a leader in providing as network and a compute online reliably, sometimes it's nice to have the maturity of a vendor that's been a little bit slower to push things into the market. You will have seen you know, we've had a couple glitches in the networking in the cloud platform. That would be an area that has come from some of the more younger software-defined networking technologies. And you'll find things like if you put in a bunch of zeros into an IP address incorrectly, that gets pushed up into the software-defined routing master controller and then takes the whole network down. And when you have hundreds of thousands of tenants, any little glitch like that is not appreciated. So we contrast that with our core business on the managed hosting, and all of that is a very mature equipment, and we really have no downtime from any sort of any of those type of issues. The network is very mature. But there needs to be, that would be, that's a problem domain that we are actively looking at solutions for.
So you mentioned Amazon. Amazon owns Zappos now, right?
Yes, they do.
And Zappos is the, quote, fanatical about the customer support.
Yeah.
Is that leaking across?
I don't know. But, you know, what we find is that what used to be helpful for us to deliver was a baseline of we'll manage your operating system, right? And that was a great bar to set for our customers. But over time, there's much more complex deployments. People have multi-node data stores that have to communicate with one another. They have whole development environments that live off of a single machine. They live in a cloud of machines, even physical machines. And so to do that, you need DevOps skills, which is the configuration management and orchestration engines. These are things like Chef and Puppet and Ansible and SaltWorks. So what we're doing now with our support team is finding those areas of expertise that are hard to get when you're developing your own your business, and we want to be able to provide those at a much higher level than we've ever done before.
A friend of mine makes a reasonably good living by looking for things that people have to do as part of their job that they don't consider their job. And they will give you money, or their managers will give you money, to take that away, to do it for them.
Yeah, sorry, the other side there said, you know, if any of you ever get a chance to go to San Antonio, we have a place called Castle for Rackspace, and there we have something called RackerU. And this is a continuous education improvement service that we provide within the company that helps elevate all the staff for modern technologies. And like even in the developer ops world, if I say things like Chef and Puppet, that's kind of challenging for most technology organizations today is even adopt those tools. And from our customers that are leading the development practices, those are actually the last generation of tools. And they're already onto these next generation like Ansible and SaltStack. So we are using our RackerU to educate our support team into technologies that our customers might not even be using yet. So when you talk about like Zappos, although like the focus on customer support, I love that there's that focus.
There's not a lot of innovation in shoes.
But to actually do that at scale, to take you know thousands of our Rackers through these programs takes a lot of diligence within the company.
Can you talk a little bit about this space in San Francisco and what kind of incubator you're running?
Yeah. So Rackspace realizes that San Francisco is you know, a real epicenter for interesting technologies, technologies that are going to move the needle. And we want to support those companies, but also feel their pains. And we get some of the best feedback from young companies that move mountains where they shouldn't be able to. So the office physically in San Francisco is at 2nd and Folsom, and the top floor of the building is the Rackspace San Francisco office. The bottom floor is a geekdom. And a geekdom is based off a similar program in San Antonio, and maybe Austin. That was the first Rackspace venture to support the technology community in that area. And so it's been a very rewarding there. We have the sister program here.
So you take some share in the venture?
No, this is not an incubator for profit. This is a non-profit endeavor, and we offer a space, so physical space, which includes a desk space, meeting space, mm-hmm. a bike space. We have shared amenities. We have a receptionist, everything you'd need to get started. It's not a for-profit focus. And on top of that, we have access to mentors. So everyone from CTO of Rackspace, to the founders at companies that have been acquired through Rackspace, to Robert Scoble,
who's a Rackspace employee. It's based out of there, does the shows out of there. So get open access to our community, and we also have packages that help with onboarding into the Rackspace technologies. So everything from our cloud computing to our apps services, our development services, and the managed hosting. It's cool. Just check it out. You're always welcome to come by. We have ping pong and I think a kegerator at some nights. So we also tend to host like the local Golang meetups that have been there.
Okay.
And we had Dart SF there, I think last night. So leading.
What's Dart SF?
Dart language.
Dart.
Yeah.
So are you coding in Dart? You mentioned that you're a Rails guy, a Ruby person. Are you exploring Dart?
I have not explored Dart, but I do like Golang. I like Golang.
Okay. Which is a different, very much, so have you explored Julia?
I have not explored Julia.
Do you know about Julia?
I do not know about Julia.
The folks who wrote Julia spoke here, right?
Yeah, everybody speaks
good. I think that language innovation right now is really, really spectacular. And, you know, I feel like we're starting to get to the point where as technology developers, it's like, we really establishing a toolbox. I see less and less people that say, I'm a Java developer and I'm never developing anything else, or I'm a Lisp programmer and I'm never developing anything else. It's, tell me about the problem domain, and I'm going to find the best tool to solve the problem in that problem domain. And so even at my last startup, the one that ended up going into Rackspace, we had a mixture of stack for all of our workflow and our account management and things like interacting with your e-commerce vendor or to do the subscription billing. You can plug and play all of that in Ruby on Rails, because the Ruby community is just, it's a sharing community, and someone writes something and the next thing you know, it's open, and you know, we've open sourced our technologies and we adopt other open technologies, but it cuts your development time down drastically. You can do all, if you want to integrate with LinkedIn and you want to integrate with Google Auth, you can do all of that with Ruby on Rails in record time. Now, if you want to run an error reporting service, which we did, and handle 20,000 requests per second with a 50 kilobyte package of XML in each request, that's actually a lot of data, it's a lot of string processing, and it's a lot of concurrency, and Rails is miserable for that. It takes up a lot of memory for every process. If you have slow response, you're using up all that memory the entire time. So we wrote all the back end in Golang, and that was actually a great fit for our particular problem, because low overhead, it could hold a million connections open on a server, it wouldn't care. So we find that we're now, the challenges for us are how do we think ahead of time to create all the right pieces that allow our whole infrastructure work together with the different systems.
I haven't heard any mention of C++ 11. I'm just curious. Obviously, you're playing with Go, but I'm just curious, are you following Stostrip and what's going on in the emerging C++ world?
I'm not active at all at the languages level, besides the fact that when something starts to have the right feel and I have a need, I will dig in, and I love the process of adopting, but I've had no reason to be on to Golang right now.
Okay.
I looked at Clojure. Clojure, I thought it was going to be good because I like Lisp, but I just don't like all the Java underneath. It left a scar for me, so
oh.
Not wanting to go back to it.